It takes more than one person to assist in a personal injury claim. I am attorney Glenn Westmoreland, and we have a strong team at the Mack Law Firm. It is our goal to make sure your injury is properly attended to. Contact me at tangilawteam.com and let us get you the help you need.
Call the Tangipahoa Parish School Board meeting for February 18th, 2021 to order. Ms. Cindy, if you do a roll call, please.
Ms. Richards?
Present.
Mr. Toler?
Here.
Ms. Abrams?
Here.
Mr. Westmoreland?
Present.
Mr. Duncan? Mr. Bush?
Here.
Mr. Moore? Here. Ms. Simmons?
Here.
Ms. Dominguez?
Present.
Okay.
If everyone would please stand for the Pledge of Allegiance.
We have a school, Ms. Cindy?
Yeah, just one second.
Good afternoon. Thank you for the opportunity to allow our students from Kentwood High Magnet School to present to you the Pledge of Allegiance, which will be presented by Jakeebus Callahan and Otis Elsie, who are both 4.0 students, and they are selected to be members of the Louisiana High School Athletic Association, all academic team in both basketball and football. And presenting to you the Star Spangled Banner is my grandson, Jamarian Tate. Thank you.
Attention, salute, pledge. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Oh, say can you see by the dawn's early lights what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose bright stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight for the rebels we watched were so gallantly streaming.
Was Kentwood High School doing the honors tonight. Okay, we're going to move on to D, consider approval of the board minutes from February 2nd, 2021. Do I have a motion?
I make a motion to accept.
Motion by Ms. Dominguez. I have a second.
Second.
Second by Mr. Westmoreland. Call for a vote.
Voting is open. Ms. Richards, yes.
Yes, Mr. Toller.
Mr. Toller, yes.
I'm getting in there right now.
My computer's not up, Ms. Cindy, yes.
Ms. Abrams, okay. Voting is closed. Motion passes unanimously.
Okay, I am getting a text message from Ms. Crow, so we might have to move from A. She says she's stuck from the bridge being out or something.
There she is right there.
Oh, there she is. Speak of the devil. She's not stuck on the bridge anymore. At this time, we're going to recognize Ms. Tanya Crow, Miss Louisiana, USA. Miss Stilley? I really don't like standing next to her very often because she's so tall and I'm so short, so I never wear heels, but I did tonight. But I would like to say a few words about Ms. Tanya Crow before we do her proclamation. I have known Tanya for a very, very long time, and give you a little back history on her. She started competing in pageants here locally in Tangipahoa Parish. She was the Tangipahoa Parish Fair Queen. And we all knew that she was beautiful and she could move on to do bigger and better things. Vicki Travis was a mentor of hers and talked her into doing Miss Louisiana system and going to the Miss USA pageant as far as Miss Louisiana USA is concerned. So she went her first year, she went her second year, she went her third year, fourth, fifth, and sixth year she competed at Miss Louisiana USA, either placing or getting in the top 15. All of those years, she never ever let it down. She was determined she was going to be Miss Louisiana USA. And lo and behold, this year, 2021, she went to New Orleans and she competed for her last time, because you age out eventually, you get too old. And so she was to the point that this was it. She was going to be too old after this year. And when they called her name out, we were watching it at our camp, and when they called her name out, the tears just started streaming because I was so extremely proud of her and her accomplishments. She's been to my very special Miss Louisiana pageant, and she's going to be definitely a mentor for these little girls to never give up on their dreams, because she didn't. And I just want to read this proclamation now. I did you know first. Whereas Ms. Tanya Crow was crowned Miss Louisiana USA and will represent Louisiana at the Miss USA pageant in 2021. And whereas Tanya graduated from Tangipahoa Parish School System and is an alumni of Southeastern Louisiana University, where she graduated in a bachelor's degree in business administration with a concentration in international business studies. Whereas a native of Amite, Louisiana, Tanya works as a professional model, a cosmetologist, and a cheerleader for the New Orleans Saints. Whereas Miss Louisiana USA competition that selects a representative for the state of Louisiana to compete in the Miss USA pageant, a program that combines all the beauty and excitement of pageantry with glamour, energy, and the runway of fashion show, while recognizing the personal achievement, community involvement, academic excellence of young women. Whereas it is important that women be encouraged in their strengths and abilities through competition, the Miss USA organization is a great outlet for young women to practice their public speaking, writing skills, to meet other driven and ambitious young women, and to acquire leadership abilities. Now, therefore, be it resolved that we, the Tangipahoa Parish School Board, do hereby congratulate Tanya Crow for being named Miss Louisiana USA 2021, and wish her the best of luck in her future endeavors.
Yeah. Or cut it off. Thank you. Look forward to watching you at the USA. I appreciate it.
Congratulations.
Does she not want to say that?
Man, we have a Miss Louisiana USA. We have a Heisman Trophy winner. We have a governor. Man, Tangipahoa Parish just makes them good out here, right? All right, we're going to move on to our academic update. B. We have to pull B from our agenda tonight, actually. And then we're going to move on to C, recognize the district students of the year. Mr. Jenko?
Could I say something about the NSF Jake Bailey? It's not that I didn't bring the award. I did, but the individual that was to receive was not here tonight.
Right.
Okay.
Right.
Start this way and then we'll turn to the group. Good evening, Ms. Stilley, board members. Hope everyone's doing well tonight. As Ms. Abrams mentioned, we have not bad. I can do that and talk at the same time.
That's impressive.
As Ms. Abrams mentioned, you know, Heisman Trophy winners, governor, Miss Louisiana USA, and we saved the best for this group right here. You know, we have unfortunately COVID had us change some few things, so we had it worked out. And then lo and behold, Louisiana becomes North Dakota, and we get the weather to come through. So we had to make some arrangements, and we will recognize the other winners of the individual schools a little bit later to give them their due. But tonight, we were able to make sure that our three district winners were here tonight, and we'd like to recognize them. First, I'd be remiss if I didn't thank Ms. Kirkland, Ms. Rose Petit, and Ms. Charlotte Tillman for all that they do to make this a very special night for our young winners. I love the show Shark Tank, so I don't know if anybody else watches Shark Tank, but there is no reason that one of these three individuals will not be on Shark Tank, could not be the next Bill Gates, the next governor, president, doctor that cures cancer, COVID, etc. So we are very excited to honor you tonight. You are the best of the best. There are 20,000 students in the Tangipahoa Parish school system, and you are the top fifth grader, the top eighth grader, and the top 12th grader. So we commend you and your family for all the effort that you have put in to getting here tonight, and we look forward to recognizing you with proclamations and so forth as you move through your career and come back. I have to say, if anybody wants to be a teacher, please teach here. Please think about that. Okay, but if you become that doctor, engineer, and so forth, come back here. Come back to Tangi. We need great young people here. So as President Miller says, move here. We want you to stay here. And if you happen to have to go off to school, please come back. Okay? Now, enough about that. So we're going to get this party started, so to speak. Our fifth grade winner is Miss Morgan Matheny from Roseland Montessori. Our eighth grade student of the year is Mr. Caden Moore from Kentwood High Magnet School.
Good morning.
And our 12th grade student of the year is Miss Anne Marie LaCour from Ponchatoula High School. Family members, friends, any school employees are here at the particular schools, please stand up. We need to recognize you also for all that you've done. And again, congratulations. And if you have not taken part in the regional competition yet, we want to wish you the best of luck. If you did, we look forward to you getting those results back. Thank you.
All right. Congratulations to everyone. We're going to move down to our awards recognition. We did our awards. Now we're going to move down to three academic updates for the National School Counseling Week presentation. Ms. Sharon Spring.
Thank you, Ms. Stilley, Ms. Abrams. In the spirit of continuing to recognize people, we took the first week of February to recognize all of our school counselors. In a normal non-COVID year, of course, we would take the time to bring all of our school counselors here to recognize them and all of what they do for our schools and our staff. What we did was we went out and we visited each of our schools and our school counselors, brought the certificate of appreciation to each of them. And you can see that we're showing on the screen now the pictures of each of our counselors when we went out and visited each of them, just to take the opportunity to thank them for all they do for our students, our staff, and our administration in each of our schools. So for those of them, we asked them to tune in tonight just to say thank you to each of them for all that they do, what they do for our schools. And hopefully next year we can get back to bringing them here, showing them our appreciation for what they do for our students and for our staff and our schools. So that'll roll through till we get to each of our schools and each of our school counselors, and then it's there if you want to go back through and watch it again. Congratulations to all of our counselors for doing such a great job.
Great, we're going to move on to four, consider committee reports. A, Personnel Committee from February 2nd, 2021. Do you have a motion to accept the committee report?
So moved.
Mr. Toler?
Second.
Second.
Ms. Sandra.
I could see who was down there. And any comments? Call for a vote, Ms. Cindy.
Voting is open. Ms. Janice? Voting is closed. Motion passes unanimously.
All right, we're going to move on to B, Policy Committee of a Whole, February 2nd, 2021. Do I have a motion?
Motion to adopt.
Motion by Mr. Westmoreland.
Second.
Second by Ms. Dominguez. Any comments? Vote, Ms. Cindy.
Voting is open. Voting is closed. Motion passes unanimously.
All right, we're moving to C, the Finance Committee report from February 11th, 2021. Do I have a motion to accept?
I'll make a motion to accept.
Ms. Dominguez made a motion. Have a second?
Second.
Second by Mr. Toler. Any comments?
Madam President, I have a couple questions.
Sure, go ahead, Mr. Bush.
Concerning the grass cutting contracts, and I was not able to make it to the Finance Committee meeting that day, and I'm sure this is probably addressed to Mr. Schnadelbach. Mr. Schnadelbach, these contracts, are they a year or two-year contracts?
Mr. Bush, they have a two-year contract.
Do they have an option to renew in 2 years like in the past, or some of them have?
No, it's just a two-year contract.
What happens, and again, like I said, I couldn't make the Finance Committee, but obviously one contractor got many groups, won the bids. What happens if that person, or any, not just in this contract, but any of them, if someone has this many, and they decide that two of them they don't want anymore, and they just call you up on the phone and say, I can't do these two.
We would go to the next low
bid. Do they still keep all the other ones that they
did? If their work is good, they would still keep the low quotes. But if they, decline their quote on a project or a job, we would go to the next low bidder.
Has that ever happened before?
It has.
Okay. I want to say this. I know the procedure was done exactly properly. I know that for a fact, but you can understand the disappointment in our community when this person lives out of state, and I do not know who they are. I have no idea, and I'm sure that person community would feel the same way if somebody from here went to Mississippi and took and got their bid. So I'm hoping that it will allow our contractors to tighten up, get better quotes. There's competition. That's the name of the game. I understand that. Last thing, is it possible in the future when I'm hindsight 2020, I didn't even think about this before, but you try to get better every time you do things. Is it possible to make it where we can keep some of this stuff closer to home when we do these bids? I mean, I know we're looking for money. I got that. I understand we're looking for cheap bids. I understand we're looking for not cheap bids or cheap work, but the lowest bids. I understand that. But when we send our money to other places other than keeping it in the parish where it just circles around and comes back and forth. So I know we save money, but not quite as much as I think people believe. Because if you're buying insurance, your vehicles, your equipment, your all your stuff in Mississippi, and your labor, and you taking all of our money over there and not bringing it here versus someone getting the contract in our parish. So here's my question. Is it possible legally, when we put out these bids in such a manner that we make it to where we give, call it special treatment to our people and our vendors?
I would defer that question to legal counsel.
And not just count on the price of the money. Chris, you understand what I'm saying?
Right.
And I don't know if it is or not.
No, you can't exclude them for that reason alone. You can require, though, certain contracts to have a local office or local presence, or an office here, or a maintenance yard here, and that can kind of keep out some of the out-of-parish competition. So that doesn't, that might not be relevant for these kinds of contracts, but for other kinds of contracts, that can be a relevant way of narrowing your choices.
Yeah. And again, I'm not saying this is a bad person. I don't know him, have no idea, but, you know, it is, it is caused some, a lot of conversations that I've had. I have a lot of phone calls about this because, so I suggest in the future when they come back up or any of them, if we can make it more exciting or a little bit better for our people. Yes, I'm telling you right now, I want everybody to shop at home and I want everybody that we use to live in Tangipahoa Parish. I want our money to stay here. I would love that. I know that's not possible, but I would love for that to happen.
Right.
So
we could do to beef that up.
Yeah, I just only suggestion.
Standby equipment be located if any equipment that went down or things like that.
Well, I think what we're trying to do it, and I watched the finance committee. I mean, we saved a lot of money, and it was done right, but we just still left out a lot of people who, and I mean, I want them to get better. Obviously, this competition is good for us, but like minorities or women or any kind of businesses that we could help, maybe, you know, not give anybody anything, but make it just a little bit better to involve more people in our area. And so, Ms. Donnebach, thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Chris. I appreciate it. Thank you, Madam President.
Anybody else?
Yes. I'd just like to clarify the Facebook acquisition that suggests that we as a race want to be given certain and special privileges. During this day and time, it still saddens me that I even have to say what we want. And what we want is fairness, the same opportunity, the same contract, and the same procedures across the board. With that being said, I do believe that Tom worked very hard on his personal contract to allow everybody to have the opportunity to bid on the lawn service contract. However, my concern is that it was a personal project, that we as a board was not made aware of it until the new contract came out, the group of the schooling, the advertising, and the bid procedures. We were made aware when the public was made aware. I just believe that had we put our heads together, that just maybe in the beginning, it would have been more acceptable and we could have kind of come up with some ideas together. But when you tell me that how hard you worked on it and how you reconstructed a contract and everything changed about it and you regrouped and all of this, and we were not made aware of it as a board. And I just think that it shouldn't have been a personal project.
Ms. Chairman.
Yeah, Mr. Toller.
Just to answer, I'd like to ask Ms. Richards then, is there anything specific that we could have done differently in the process?
I think that we would have been made aware of it and we would have talked about it. Some of the concerns, one of the concerns could have been how we advertised, were we going to use Facebook, were we going to use our regular procedure, or were we going to allow the biddings from outside of the area. I mean, we would just talked about it first as opposed to being hit with it at the voting.
Right. Just to clarify one thing, you know, we as the board, we don't make these, we don't shop, we don't go out on bid, we approve or deny the administration's recommendation.
Mm-hmm.
Being a contractor, mm-hmm. from before I was even on the board, you can ask Mr. Snottlebach, I have been asking for to put these on bid so we can get competitive prices so we can go out and get more prices.
Yes.
So just to answer your question as far as sharing, I share anything on Facebook to everybody to try to broaden that reach out to get prices on anything. I'll do the same thing on bus contracts. I'll do the same thing on anything. So this was not a personal vendetta of me trying to get this to a certain person, because I don't know Mr. Diaz. I've never met him until the other day at the finance meeting. He did find out about it on Facebook through a contact. I think he has family in Ponchatoula, and he actually lives in Slidell, not Mississippi, but his LLC is listed out of Mississippi. But just to reiterate, you know, we do business with people in Baton Rouge. We do business with vendors in New Orleans, with people in St. Tammany, in Mississippi, across the line. We as a school system, our parish is not big enough to provide everything. Now, obviously, we have plenty of grass cutters. But I do throw this out there. If there's something specifically that we did wrong, I say we, the administration, that we didn't reach somebody, I definitely want to fix that. And I want to do this every 2 years. But I have a feeling, going back to what Mr. Bush is saying, and I agree 100%, I wish every contract we do here dealt with somebody in Tangipahoa Parish. I honestly do. But I also feel like that when we politically swap things to give it to somebody local because of who they are or because of, then we won't get competitive prices. We get competitive prices when we do a fair process and we do a bid process to everybody, and those prices come down. I have a feeling in 2 years from now, you're going to see competitive prices from local guys because they know they have to compete with people outside of this area. That's why we're saving the taxpayers money right now with lower bids, because competition brought that price down. And I applaud the administration for doing that and opening that up. And I hope in 2 years from now that our local guys beat the socks off of everybody and they get all that business back here in Tangipahoa Parish. But that's the fair way to do it in this process, and I think the process was done completely fair.
All right, I want to say a little something on this as well. The administration did do a fair process with this. By no means that did y'all do anything that you weren't supposed to do. You came in here, you opened the bids in front of everyone. As far as the process, it was done fairly. And I mentioned this in the Finance Committee meeting when we had it, that if we're going to advertise, whether it's personal Facebook pages by the school board members or by the school board, we need to do it with everything that we do, with every contract that we do. Don't just push one particular bid as far as grass cutting or whatever we may do, because it was pushed so hard on Facebook, we got so many people to come and do bids. It got around really quickly, and that's why we got a lot of people from out of town to come and bid. I've really struggled with how I'm going to vote on this, because we have to do what's right with our money in Tangipahoa Parish school system. And what's right with our money is making sure that we give it to the lowest bidder. And a lot of people out there have said, but y'all have given it to a higher bidder before in other situations. This person didn't vote for the higher bid in the last situation. So I just want to put it out there that, you know, whether we believe this was done deliberately or you believe it was done fairly in the system itself. We just have to move forward now and in the next 2 years, and hopefully, as Mr. Toler said, people will get competitive and want to come and bid on these contracts and know that it's going to be a fair process, because I do believe that our administration did do a fair process. Anyone else?
Yeah, I'd just like to say again, I'm talking from hindsight. I did not get involved in the process before about the contracts, but let me just say, and maybe I'm different than other people, it's not just about money, especially when you send it somewhere else and it's not recurring and going back in Tangipahoa Parish around and around and around. We might have saved money, we might not. I hope the man does a good job, who knows. When you're three times cheaper, and Mr. Mingus said this in the Finance Committee meeting, than other people, God bless him, wish him well. But so I just still think we ought to have some kind of way to get our people more involved. Even if it's a few thousand bucks here and there, they're going to put that money back in our economy in Tangipahoa Parish, and that's what's important. And of course, are taking care of our community also. But again, I'm like Robin. I think the process was done fair. I mean, I
agree
with you. What we put out there, it came back just like what we look for. So I'm just hoping next time we can tweak it.
I agree with you, Mr. Bush, and I hope that we can find a way that we can offer it, as our council said, to maybe just say you have to have a home base in Tangipahoa Parish for these smaller contract bids for our smaller people that are struggling to keep their business afloat.
Well, okay. And that's exactly what I was suggesting. Had we had an input at the initial of it, maybe we would have come up with these ideas.
I agree.
And one other question I was asked, Mr. Stein, about, are they, any of these people got the groups, are they going to be allowed to store their equipment on our school sites instead of carrying it back and forth? Okay.
No.
Thank you.
Now, I think we were told that Mr. Diaz will be renting a facility, a storage facility here. So, I mean, that'll be tax dollars coming in.
Well, Mr. Diaz told me that he cuts multiple places already in the Hammond area, and he cuts one of the hotels, and he has made arrangements with the hotel that his crew will be staying at the hotel and renting storage space at the hotel.
So we have a motion and we have a second. So we call for a vote, Ms. Cindy, if no one else has any questions.
Voting is open. Voting is closed. Motion passes with Mr. Bush, Mr. Moore, and Ms. Richards voting no.
All right, we're going to move on to our superintendent's report and recommendations.
Yes, Madam President. I would ask the board tonight for item 5A to consider approval to refer policies from Section K of the policy manual and GBRIB, which is the sick leave, to the policy, the next policy committee for review.
I'll make a motion to send those policies to policy committee.
I'll second.
So we got a motion by Ms. Dominguez, second by Mr. Westmoreland. Take a vote, Ms. Cindy.
Voting is open. Voting is closed. Motion passes unanimously.
Okay, other board actions. Consider approval of Phase 1 financing plan. Mr. Schnattelbach.
Thank you, Ms. President. At this time, I'm going to ask Mr. Misaki to come up. He's going to make a brief presentation on our financing for our Phase 1 projects and the approach we have taken and a recommendation, and ask you all to consider approval. Thank you.
Thank you, Brett. Thank you. I can do it. Good. Thanks so much. Pleasure to be with you again, and my privilege to serve you. The purpose of our spending a few minutes with you this evening follows on with the commitment we made to you as we began this financing process, is to come back to you and continue to keep you posted on our progress, on our activities, and where we're headed with this financing of your Phase 1 capital improvements. So for tonight, we determined it best, especially since we're moving forward now with our submission to the State Bond Commission, it's an appropriate time to talk to you about where we are in the process and what that process is going to look like from this point forward. In municipal securities world, they call that a plan of financing, and that's what I'm here to brief you on tonight. Not intended to be an introduction to municipal finance, but Brett, myself, and Ms. Stilley determined it best to give you an understanding of that plan of financing, meaning the path we want to proceed with, specifically what direction we're headed and why we're headed in that direction.
And can you make it elementary for me so I can understand it? You're already making me nervous. I don't know a lot about it, sir, so you might want to talk slow and break it down for me.
I don't intend to read these slides, but I will do my best to break it down and take whatever time you need, it's a brief presentation. First off, from a background standpoint, we're talking about here the issuance of tax-exempt municipal bonds. And tax-exempt because the purchasers, the investors in those bonds, don't pay income taxes on the interest earned. And what that means to you is it results in a lower interest rate than if we were financing with a standard commercial financing under for commercial terms. There, under that, number two, there are really two types and categories of municipal bonds that school districts typically issue, and to that end, one is general obligation bonds, and those are bonds that are secured by property taxes. Second is what the industry calls revenue bonds, and that's what we're moving forward with, and that would be bonds that are backed by sales taxes, which is the case here, or things like utility revenue bonds for parishes and municipalities that issue water revenue bonds or sewer revenue bonds, the repayment sources of bonds, or fees sometimes people build bridges or toll roads, and they use the use those tolls or fees as the revenue source. Forgive me. As a revenue source for repayment of bonds. In this case, we are talking about the issuance of revenue bonds, sales tax revenue bonds specifically. Next slide. From a revenue bond standpoint, there really are two different sources of where those revenue bonds.
I moved it.
You got it?
Thank you for the help, I think.
Yeah. Hey, you stay out of finance. Don't butter your stuff. You don't butter this.
Two. One is, the source and structure of the funding of these bonds is really depending on who's buying the bonds. Whether it's a bank, is what we call bank placements, or the bond market, which is the capital market, the bond market. And under that heading, under bond market financing, there's really two ways to structure or two ways to proceed. One is a competitive offering, and the other is negotiated, and I'll talk about that in just a moment. But with regard to banks, under bank placements or bank financing, often they're lower in cost and fees because you don't have to, you don't buy bond insurance because the bank is underwriting that risk themselves. You have other fees and costs. You don't need a trustee and all those kinds of things that are unique to the bond market. But often you also have, so you have lower cost and fees, but more often than not, you're going to find that that banks have a bit higher interest rate than what the bond market would have to offer. And you need to balance those two, the cost against the interest rates. There's some flexibility with structuring, there's prepayment options that are all make bank financing for municipal bonds really attractive for, depending on what that the size of structure and what your intent is. Follow that again, and flipping that to talking more about the bond market. As I've described to you before, there are two different ways to proceed with regard to bond market financing. One is competitive, what the industry calls competitive, and that is where we produce an official statement, we submit it out to the world, and underwriters from all over the region, country, whatever, get a chance to bid on that. And those are really best for frequent issuers, of which you're not. It's been quite some time since you've issued bonds. It is best for highly rated issuers, and I feel strongly you're going to be have a strong credit rating, but beyond that, it is also preferred to do competitive issues in stable markets. One is of which we're not in right now. We hadn't been for quite some time. With COVID and everything else, lots of uncertainty in the market, and you know that based on what your sales tax reports look like and what other indicators are. Even though fortunately sales tax has been strong in Tangipahoa Parish, so for all of that, the negotiated approach is what we're recommending, is where we select an underwriter. And that underwriter becomes part of the finance team, and we go as a team to market, and it allows us to time when we're going to seek pricing for these and interest rates for this. It also gives us the opportunity to negotiate better and structure better final rates and terms, and it's preferred often, and based on my experience after 25 years, especially for infrequent issuers, as you are, and unstable markets. They're There are school boards in the state, for instance, St. Martin Parish Schools is one of my clients. And every 2 years for the last 10 years, we've been going out to market for general obligation bonds for school constructions and school renovations. So they would be a frequent issuer, and as a result, a lot easier to do things competitively with a school district like that. For you, again, considering the uniqueness of who you are, what you're all about, my strongest recommendation to you is we proceed with a negotiated issue. Follow that for a minute. Why it allows us negotiating, forming a finance team that includes the underwriter allows us to better time the market. There's situations when we would be preparing to seek bids on bonds this coming Tuesday, and on Friday and Monday we look at what other offerings are out there, and we determine that there's so much competition for bonds now that there's so many other issues in the market that it's going to affect rates negative to us. It actually would result in higher interest rates because we're going to have to shop those among so many people because there's so much competition for bonds. So that's what a negotiated offering allows us to do, is be able to pull back and say, we're not going to market this week. We're going to wait until that school district gets done, and then we're going to go to market. So we're going to postpone it for 2 weeks, and we think as a result we're going to end up shaving, points off of our interest rate, and as a result, providing better value to your taxpayers. Also allows us to take advantage of an underwriter's experience, particularly in school district bonds and K-12 bonds, because it's a unique market. And for those that have substantial experience in marketing, underwriters that have substantial experience in marketing school district bonds, it's a considerable difference in interest rate because the people they're selling those bonds to, they're used to buying school district bonds. They understand how you look, how you work, how you act, and as a result, it's much more competitive, and as a result, it drives your interest rate lower. Remember, this is fine points of how this proceeds, but it is it's part science, part art in understanding just how best to frame this to reduce our interest rates and our cost of money as low as possible. And that's my responsibility to you, is to drive down the cost of money as far as we can. So the net benefit to you, what we hope as a result of this and what we expect based on my experience, is that negotiated bond offering will result in a lower interest rate and more favorable terms to the school district. So I'm headed in the home stretch. From providing some conclusions and recommendations, what we did, since we've had time over the last several months since you engaged us, we've had an opportunity to spend time with a local community bank and have them come back with a preliminary proposal to us, rates and terms. We've also had a chance to bring in Stiefel, an experienced K-12 underwriter, and have a chance to put them side by side and look at rates, terms, costs, and factor those together. And the last slide really just gives you a quick look at what both of their proposals were to us in terms of what the cost of money is over term. And if you notice, working with a bond underwriter, and this specifically Stiefel's proposal to us, that total annual savings over the 20-year term of these bonds would be over $300,000. So again, it helps to understand in principle, but it's even more beneficial when you get a chance to look at the specifics, trying our best to apples to apples this and focusing on, okay, what is our least costly capital source? So the result of that, as I mentioned to you before, as I mentioned and showed you in those numbers, there was a higher issuance cost and higher fees associated with a negotiated underwriting, but it's overcome by a higher interest rate from the community bank, and as a result, those costs offset and formulated our recommendation to you that we proceed with this financing using a negotiated bond offering structure and utilizing Stiefel as a bond underwriter, and that's our recommendation to you, and we're asking for you to approve that plan of finance that finance plan for your phase 1 capital projects. And I'm certainly available for any questions you might have about this.
Mr. Duncan?
Can you explain a little bit more about the role of the underwriter as far as why. I appreciate the presentation and it was very good, but if you could tell us a little bit more about what the underwriter does, and I see the value, but
it's easy to look at the numbers. Make sure forgive me, but that's a great question that I just glossed right over after this much time in this world. The underwriter actually buys your bonds. And as a result, they buy them because they're going to resell them to their retail investors, you know, people who go to Stifel, and their Stifel's investment advisor, you know, their financial advisor is at Stifel, and their retirement is with Stifel, and their advisor sells, you know, markets some of those bonds to them to put in their, you know, to use some of their retirement funds for. They also market those bonds to institutions, insurance companies, pension funds, you know, so between not only retail but also institutional investors. So at the time of sale, they give us a firm commitment that we're going to buy these bonds at an average interest rate of 1.9%, and they're responsible for marketing those bonds and making sure they go out such that they make a profit on that. But for all of that, they've given us the lowest cost of money, and that's what an underwriter does. An underwriter purchases those bonds.
And is that another way of saying that they're the ones that loan us the money?
True.
And when it's time to pay back, though, they may have sold the loan to some other person, and we would be paying that other person back when it's time to pay back, or do we pay the underwriter back?
We're actually going to have a paying agent.
It'll
be a bank that'll serve in that capacity. They'll collect your payments and distribute them to whoever the bondholders are at the time.
And so when you gave us those options at the end, the other option, so rather than using the underwriter, the other option is to just work directly with a local bank, is what you were saying, and they would be the ones that would loan us the money, so to speak.
Yeah, and it would look and act more like a traditional loan, right? Even though it would still be bonds. So it would be that bank, and that bank would be buying those bonds for their own account.
And you said that you've already spoken with a local bank that could do this, but and gave them the opportunity to have this business with us, but in the end they were going to come out around $300,000 more expensive?
All true.
Okay. And so
keep in mind, Mr. Duncan,
go ahead.
It was an iterative process going back and forth, working through, trying our best to make sure that they understood exactly what we were looking for, and as a result, they get another look at it and you know, more time with it, more time with their community. So it wasn't simply give me a number,
right?
I'll tell you whether it's good or not. No,
we tried very hard to make it work with a local bank, is what you're saying.
Absolutely.
But ultimately, they gave us the best they could do, and this other option gave us a much better offer.
Yes, sir. Simply put.
Okay.
And as a result, and it's often the case, especially when we had the time to do this like we did while we're waiting on all of the approvals required in order to be able to move forward with this. So we used that time. But between Brett and myself, we spent a lot of time going back and forth to try our best to negotiate the best, most favorable terms for you. And then bottom line, what are those, how do we apples to apples at, and which one really is the better value to you?
Well, thank you for the presentation, and thank you for the work. It looks like this is another one of those where it really would have been nice to use a local vendor, but at the end of the day, you know, our ultimate obligation is to all of the taxpayers in our parish and making sure that we give the best deal to all of the taxpayers in the parish, or at least that's it looks like your work is helping us to do that again. So,
all right.
Without getting into a lot more details on all of that, they had every opportunity to be our recommendation, and at the end, we're not.
Did the bank approach you, or you approached that?
Let's go ahead and make a motion, and then we can keep discussing if we want to make
Move to adopt the administration's recommendation.
Second.
All right, we got a motion by Mr. Duncan, a second by Mr. Westmoreland. Call for a vote, Ms. Cindy.
Mr.
You can ask, you let Randy.
Oh, go ahead, Randy.
Did the bank approach you, or you approached the bank?
We approached them.
What if a bank approaches you tomorrow? Is it too late to try to see with another local bank? Just curiosity.
Likely not.
Okay.
Those kinds of things can still occur. You always want to be, until you have a deal, you don't have a deal.
Well, look, they all know we're doing it because it's out there. So they all had an opportunity to contact Mr. Steinbach.
At the end of the day, we try our best to be formal and polished. But for all of that, we felt like we've satisfied the competition required.
Thank you, sir.
And based on the size of the transaction, well, keep in mind, you're not to exceed $23 million in bonds eliminates many small banks that aren't capable, that don't have lending limits of that size.
I have a question. So you already have an underwriter already established?
Our recommendation
one that you're recommending?
Is to move forward with Stiefel. Yes.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Mr. Moore, they are the leading K-12 bond underwriter in the country, significantly higher than second place. So lots of experience in that world of financing for school districts.
Representative lives in our parish, and his kids' children in our school.
Okay.
Can you say that louder?
There we go. Stiefel representative is in the audience. Is Mr. Toby Cortez. He lives in Ponchatoula, and his kids attend our school.
Thank you.
And he is a member of the organization that you're recommending?
Yes,
underwriter?
Yeah, he's a representative for Stiefel, Stiefel Nicholas and Company, the underwriters. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Sure, thanks so much. My name's Toby Cortez, and I'm the banker that works the transactions for Stiefel. And it's such an honor to be in front of you right now. We actually, Stiefel as a bank, actually does 9 K-12 transactions a week across the country. And so we're in the market, and we know this market. That's why we're able to give you the lowest cost of capital. And it's such an honor to be. I was talking to my daughter, telling her what I was doing today, and she could actually understand it. She goes to Ponchatoula, and so hopefully some of this money goes to Ponchatoula. But it was such an honor to be able to tell her what I was doing tonight. I've done this, and I've been hired all over the state. We represent over 35 of the school districts. We work, and I've been working for 25 years. I just happen to live in Ponchatoula. And so it is a local.
And God brought you to Ponchatoula, man. What are you talking about? What you mean happened to him?
You should have.
I would have more than happy to sit down with any of you and explain in detail how the process goes. I am a geek with this stuff. I love this. I don't find too many people who want to talk about it. So I'd be happy to talk to anybody who wants to talk about it. Love to.
Thank you.
I should have warned you ahead of time. That was what was going to happen if you called him to the mic.
Yeah, that would have been a good lead.
All right, Ms. Cindy, anybody else? Any other questions? Ms. Cindy, we'll call for a vote.
I've been real picky about this, Madam President, but I feel real good. You did a lot of work, Mr. Steinbach. You know your stuff, buddy.
You know the formula. Bring somebody from Ponchatoula.
That's it.
And then we're good now.
All you got to say is go Green Wave.
Maybe I should have said that first.
Online voting is open.
It's all pre-programmed for you.
My guys is also I make the right move, yeah.
Mr. Richards. Online voting is closed. Motion passes unanimously.
Again, I thank you for the privilege of serving you.
Thank you. All right, we're going to move on to 6B, consider approval of the 2021-2022 school calendar, option 1 traditional.
So move.
Second.
Motion by Mr. Tom, second by Ms. Sandra. Any questions? Anybody got any questions about the calendar?
I'd like to say this to everybody here, this, that from the public standpoint who called me about this, Ms. Stilley listened to the employees and the public. We chatted about this calendar, and I'd like to say thank you, Ms. Stilley, making this decision, because you heard what our people and our parents were saying, and I think this was the best option at this point in time.
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Bush. This was the majority of our employees supported this calendar. We put out 4 options, as you well know. 2 were traditional and 2 were balanced. We respectfully, would ask the board to approve what our employees have recommended. Just to give you a highlight here, The teachers would start on April, I'm sorry, not April.
August.
The teachers would start on August the 5th and have four professional days before the students would arrive on the 11th of August, which is pretty similar to what happened this year. Well, with COVID, it didn't actually happen that way. We have the typical Labor Day in September. We have Fair Day scheduled October 1st as normal. We have the week of Thanksgiving as typical. We have the Christmas break, the New Year's, which is usually a two-week period there. We've got 3 days for Mardi Gras schedule, which starts on the 28th of February and goes to March 2nd. We have Good Friday and the week of after Thanksgiving. And then Easter. I don't know what's wrong with me tonight, but Thanksgiving. Thanks, Robin. And then in May, the students have their final day on the 23rd of May, teachers' professional development day on the 24th of May, which is well beyond before Memorial Day on the 30th. So they actually will finish up on Tuesday on the 24th and then have, you know, 3 or 4 days or 5 days before Memorial Day. So that's how the year falls out. There are 2 days that you'll see in green, like if Cindy goes up on the calendar a little bit, you'll see them. They're shaded that pretty green color. And those are full virtual days for students where we can have parent conferences for staff and parents on those days. So only 2 days the whole year for virtual. And then those little pink shaded or purple shaded areas would be the end of the 9 weeks. So we asked the board if they would consider this option one traditional.
Do you have a question?
Yeah, yes, we do.
Question. Ms. Stilley, can we talk a little bit about just the October 29th full virtual day? Mm-hmm. And because I have constituents that have a very, very low tolerance for any more virtual days for students that have not elected to be virtual. It mm-hmm. creates a significant burden on working parents. I think they tolerated it this year because, you know, I mean, it was just a strange year. Mm-hmm. But I need help, I guess, from you on selling them on this idea of them having to take off a day of work on October the 29th. The January 7th day, everybody loves it. They're going to have 2 nice weeks after Christmas off. That's, mm-hmm. you know, that one's tied to a holiday, but mm-hmm. the one on October 29th is kind of random and, you know, not tied to anything else. And then put on top of that, this one that we had most recently where we were supposed to have this whole host of parent-teacher conferences, I have yet to hear of one that actually occurred. So just help me, I guess, understand a little bit better or give me some sort of explanation that I can give to those families for that particular day. That's all.
Well, the other option, I think there's the option of, I guess traditionally what we would do in the past before we had one-to-one, we would just not have school that day. And so it would extend a day or take a holiday or, you know, add a day at the end or whatever. We did want the benefit of having a parent-teacher day in the calendar, at least a couple of them. And then I also think that having just 2 days in the whole year to do full virtual, I think it allows the opportunity for students to use the platform and stay familiar with the virtual platform. If we would have an incident where we had to, you know, cancel school for an extended amount of time because of whatever natural thing that might happen in the world that given year. But we think that it allows them to practice those skills that, you know, of going to the platform, knowing where the assignments are, being able to watch a lesson of a teacher's lesson, complete an assignment. So, you know, that was the purpose of building those days in. This year, you know, obviously with COVID, we had a lot more of those days. So I think that just by having the 2 days on this next year is not an excessive amount. Really, just the 1 day in October is the one that sort of is, you know, not doesn't fall like at a holiday period. And so it does allow for the teacher conferences to occur. And there were teacher conferences. I mean, not obviously with every student in the parish, but also it allows for teachers to do, they could do small group instruction. There's lots of flexibility on those days that they could have small groups of kids that they are, you know, working with in a virtual platform as well. So there is that flexibility for that. And, you know, I don't think that is excessive, but that would be the rationale.
Go ahead.
Are there any weather days in this calendar?
I believe there are several, at least two emergency days built in this calendar.
Okay.
Yep.
The rate we're going, we might need, no, not even
no,
say
we're
going
to think positive, Ms. Abrams. We're not going to need any of those.
All right. So anybody else have any questions? All right, Ms. Cindy, we'll call for a vote.
Voting is open. Voting is closed. Motion passes unanimously.
All right, we're going to go to 7 with our board members' comments and personal privilege. Start down there with Mr. Bush since he's been so talkative tonight.
Seemed like it every week, right? First of all, I'd like to say my sincere, heartfelt, I don't know what I would say, condolences to Janice again. She lost another family member. I'm sorry, man, it's about your aunt. Also to your area and Tom's area with all this storm, because I know y'all got it a lot worse than what we did in Ponchatoula. I went to LaRange and Tickfall yesterday, and I was shocked about what I saw up there, considering what I saw down here. I said, I know it's been something. Also, Ponchatoula High School girls are 28-0 playing tonight in the first round of the playoffs. I don't know what happened, but they ranked number one in the state, and I've seen it. And we're going to have another state championship in Stilley very soon, it looks like. Right? Our Ponchatoula Junior High boys and girls won the district this year, first time in history, both won it. Our bass fishing team, we got three teams, did very well in this cold weather. I'm catching it all right. Switching gears real quick. You might not have ever heard of Trey Smoltz, but Trey Smoltz is now the top news boss at WBRZ. He's overseeing the news programming. He is now the director of news. Trey Smoltz is a Ponchatoula High School graduate, 2006.
Student of Mrs. Duncan.
We keep giving here at this parish and our graduates with Tanya and Heisman Trophy Governor. I can keep going. Folks, I'm still not finished. In honor of Black History Month, my friend Louis Joseph, I just want to say he is a pioneer, and he was the first in many things that happened in our parish. So my buddy Louis Joseph, let me read you from the Los Angeles Times, April 26, 2005. Earl Wilson, the first black player signed by the Boston Red Sox, who threw a no-hitter against the Los Angeles Angels in 1962, has died. He was 70 years old. While that was so exciting, he played for Detroit, he played for San Diego. He had an 11-year major league career. Earl Wilson was a native of Ponchatoula, Louisiana. Graduated from, I think it was Greenville Park High School back in that day. He saw limited action in 1960. He reached the majors for good in 1962. I want to end with this. He not only pitched a no-hitter against the Angels on June 26th at Fenway Park, he beat them 2-0. He also hit a home run. He was one of the best hitting pitchers that's ever played in the major league. Again, Black History Month, I would like to salute. Never met Earl Wilson, but I just know of him, and I like to salute his family and say I'm proud to say he was a bunch of children a graduate of Tangipahoa Parish Public School System. Thank you, Madam President.
Ms. Sandra?
Yeah, as I read about different ones that are without power and lights, I just can't even imagine how terrible it must be for so many people. I just got a text from somebody, and AMEET is still out since near this board, this office. This has been out since Monday. And somebody mentioned earlier that they were cold even with heat on. You would never believe how I look every day at my house. I mean, it's a sight. I wear all kinds of stuff, and I'm still cold with the heat on. It just can't seem to produce. And I think about all these other people that are so cold, and some of them no water. It's just, you know, it's heartbreaking. But we're praying that that's going to change real soon.
Mr. Duncan? Ms. James?
I agree. Ms. Sandra, as a matter of fact, I'm hoping that when I get home tonight, I will have light. Yes, light, heat, water, all of the above. But again, we tough times, and we're tough people. So we will survive this, and this too shall pass.
Mr. Westmore?
I'm good tonight. Thank you.
Mr. Toler?
Yeah, just real quick, just to reiterate, this week was another example of how diverse our parish is from the south end to the north end. And, you know, there's times when floods affect the south end and the north end is dry. And so it was good to see the flexibility today that some schools were allowed to remain closed because of water problems and power and et cetera. So I do appreciate the administration working with us on that. It was heartbreaking to hear, you know, yesterday morning, I think, when we first initially told the employees we were planning on opening today, started getting flooded with calls. I didn't realize how many teachers we still had that were without power. And we have a lot of teachers that come in from Pike County and AMEET County. And like Mr. Bush said, it's amazing. I had to go to Macomb twice because of car washing and pipes. When you cross from like Fluker north, it just got icy and it stayed icy. And then when you got across like Osaka and Chattawa, it's still solid ice. So we have a lot of employees. In fact, I think the one that Ms. Andrew was going to award tonight, it lives in the Liberty area, that's still without power. And talking to a principal today that couldn't get to Sumner because she had limbs and trees, and then to hear of custodians going and cutting trees to get employees so they can come to work. But last but not least, I want to commend at Sumner, today when I went there, the maintenance crew. There was tons of maintenance guys there, you know, vacuuming up water, and we had three big water leaks, frozen pipes at Sumner because of power that had been out for several days. But not only that, the custodians from Chesbro, I believe, Spring Creek and Sumner all came together for 2 days mopping and trying to dry the school out. It wouldn't have been able to be open today, but tomorrow it should be, and it will be. But I just want to commend the custodians, all the different teachers and the administrators that were there today working, trying to get that school dried up, as well as our maintenance guys that were there in force making that happen. So commend everybody for their work.
Ms. Dominguez?
Yes, I was going to say that too. I was going to commend the maintenance department, not in general for the north end, but for just in general. And I know our staff had to go to the school to make sure nothing was broken in the pipes when we were all warmed at home in front of our fireplaces, yeah. Right? So thank y'all. I know that was a lot of work. And also just wanted to say a little bit about Mr. Toby Cortez. I'd met him several years ago. I think they're going to do wonderful with our bonds and selling the negotiating prices. He seems to be such a dynamic person, as y'all could tell. And just a shout out for him. He does live in Ponchatoula, and he's also in those plays that the Swamp Light Theater put on occasionally. So he's very dynamic, but he is a good banker. So we're really blessed to have him. And also for your department, I know y'all went through a lot of work working with this Trinity company to get the best prices. And also congratulations to Miss Tanya Crow. We're proud of her. We're proud of that we have Miss Louisiana living right here in our neighborhood. And to you, Miss Janice, again, we're sorry. I mean, you've lost your brother, you lost your aunt. It's just heartbreaking. I know I lost my sister, and it hits you at the worst times. So we'll just keep praying for you, and God bless you, and hope that things settle down for you soon. Thank y'all.
Mr. Cherry?
Yeah, first of all, my condolences, Jay. I mean, I just went through something very similar to that. And so my heartfelt sympathies go out to you. I just want to, well, refresh the memory of the teachers of a speaker that we had at the beginning of the, I think it was the 2019-2020 school year at the rally that we had, kind of spoiled this year because of the COVID, we were not able to have that. But I think she told us about a story of when she was a little girl and how a teacher inspired her and how that inspiration led to her current position because that teacher believed in her so much. I think that a lot of the problems that we're having with the children, and I'm expressing this because of my concern about the grade level of some of the schools in the parish. And I know the teachers are looking for answers for this. I think that there's no other answer except love. And by expressing to a child that they mean something, that you care about, whether or not they're successful in your in benefiting from your teaching, there is a 90% chance that you are actually going to inspire that child to want to learn for you. I mean, find something to compliment them on every day, their shoes, the way some little girl has her hair plaited today. But just finding some way to acknowledge children and to help them to understand how much importance they have to you. Not to the world, of course. Every child has an importance in the world, but just expressing how much every child means to you. They're the reason you're there. They're the reason that you have a job. So by doing this, you can help to ensure that our students are more successful in these courses that they're taking, that they're going to retain and exhibit that retention during test times and other times when they have to demonstrate, you know, how well the school system is working and teaching them.
Nothing? I would like to say LaRonja is playing tonight as well, the Lady Wolves, and I'm sure there's one Lady Wolf up in heaven that's going to be cheering them on, Miss Chambers. I'm sure she's going to be watching them from above tonight. Janice, so sorry about your family. And we're going to go into executive session now. Mr. Duncan, you read the...
Move that we enter into executive session to consider the cases of Candace Wheat versus Tangipahoa Parish School System, Mark Miller versus Tangipahoa Parish School Board, and Tyrone Ard versus Tangipahoa Parish School System.
Need a second.
Second.
Yep. Before we get started, I would like to say we forgot something.
What?
Somebody's
Our
birthday?
Superintendent's birthday was yesterday. Happy birthday to you.
Well, thank you. Will Ms. Robin lead us in happy birthday?
Well, no, she got her singing by text. She's not going to get it in public. Mr. Duncan, if you can go ahead and...
On the matter of Candace Wheat versus Tangipahoa Parish School System, move to adopt council's recommendation.
Second.
First and a second.
Yes.
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 Yeah. Y'all doing what I'm doing? I'm singing out early.
You showed us the way.
Bad influence on you.
Voting is closed. Motion passes.
On the matter of Mark Miller versus Tangipahoa Parish School Board, move to adopt council's recommendation.
Second.
Without objection.
Anybody that's yes?
Yes.
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 On the matter of Tyrone Ard versus Tangipahoa Parish School System, move to adopt council's recommendation.
Second.
Without objection.
There's no public input. Call this meeting adjourned.
I'm attorney Pat Dunn. Auto accidents are a part of life.
I hope you never need an attorney, but if you do, the team at the Mack Law Firm is here to help. Don't be intimidated by large insurance companies who just want to make your problem go away. We are here to represent your rights and interests. Contact me today at tangilawteam.com and let's get to work.